All right, today we're going to be talking about my PvE musket setup finally. This is, in my opinion, one of the most underrated weapons in PvE in New World. We're going to talk about why, and I'm going to show you some PvE gameplay at the end. A full worm run with my guild, we do worm daily, and if you're on the server Pisces, we actually also offer raffle carries for free. But besides the point, we'll jump onto that later. We'll talk about the build itself, because I want to get right into the meat and bones, the stuff you're probably most interested in, and then you can stick around for the gameplay at the end of how the build performs. So, to start off with, we'll talk about the artifacts, the most important pieces of the build. Now, first and foremost, finisher. This is the core element of the build, and you're probably thinking, oh, bleed rapier. Nope, this is not a bleed rapier. We're using it for the finisher's harmony perk. This finisher's harmony perk works on both weapons, which means if we have a bleed from any source, not even our own bleed, on the boss or enemy we're hitting, we gain 15% extra damage for both our rapier and our musket. Which is why this is the best PvE ranged offhand in the game. You're probably thinking, what about Lifetaker? Lifetaker only has a damage over time effect bonus. So we'll quickly show you, or I'll quickly show you. You're probably thinking, Disintegrate on Lifetaker, wouldn't that be better because that applies rend? You're correct, Disintegrate itself does apply rend, which is 10% rend, but the thing is, the rend cap is 50% on enemies and bosses. We have rend bots for that, or a role that is called a rend bot. It is not your role as a ranged player to apply rend. That is what your rend bot will be doing. They generally run a hatchet and a hammer, and their job in your raid, in your dungeon, whatnot, is to apply rend. You should not have that role. If you are lacking rend, then you could potentially try Lifetaker. But ultimately, if you have a rend bot, you're going to be losing DPS using the Lifetaker, as the dots from negative energy, or the dots from the disintegrate, do not come close to the effects of finisher's harmony, making this the outstanding performer when it comes to maximizing your DPS in a raid group from a ranger perspective, and again, ensuring that you have a rend bot in your team. If you don't have a rend bot in your team, you should, and you'll be running the wrong raid composition. Now, we're actually going to talk about a raid composition later in the video. Not a speedrunning one, just a normal, regular worm raid composition that we use in our company that has yielded phenomenal results. You know, 10-minute runs on average, one bangs all around, and I think I almost have like 60 completions of Worm on fresh start. You know, we do multiple runs a night, and we're at the point where we confidently can carry multiple people through it, and we'll talk about that later. And this is the musket build I use for that. And again, we rely on that finisher to get things really maximized or min-maxed DPS-wise. Now, the second most important thing is the hoplite musket, right? The hoplite musket is best in slot for PvE. And again, it comes with the Stain Infliction and Keenly Jagged. We're going to be adding the Flame Attunement to this. Now, I'm going to talk about a couple things here. You're probably wondering, why are we running Flame Attunement? Why are we running Augmented Ignited, etc.? So, first and foremost, the Worm itself. We'll talk about the Worm and Hive of Gorgons. But the Worm, so Sharnish and the Devourer, actually has no damage buffs. So, I think he has 1% extra to I think thrust, if I'm not mistaken. Where is he? Yeah, so Sharnish and the Devourer has 1% more thrust damage, not much. In turn, min max, you're hitting for 10k a shot easily with this setup. 15k on average, 30k max. You're not really gonna notice this, right? Regardless, this doesn't really matter. You could play any element you wanted to for Sharnish, but the reason why we do fire is for Hive of Gorgons, because Hive of Gorgons takes 5% more fire damage, and this is actually noticeable. 5% is almost like having another enchanted, and this is where you actually begin to min-max things, and it actually starts to yield results, and is more specifically why we run the fire split and fire damage increases for this build, which we'll jump into a little bit here. Because all of these mobs, the adds, Ichna, the first boss, Typhoon, the second boss, Broodmother, the last boss, and all of your adds inside Hive of Gorgons take 5% more fire damage. There are some disparities. I think maybe one of the mobs in Hypogorgons is I think more thrust, like, but that's like one mob out of all of them, pretty much the majority of fire damage. So that's sort of the min-max there. That is the reason why we lean into that fire damage. So we're gonna add Flame Attunement to our Hotfire Musket. We're gonna add that augmented ignited. We will jump onto Priebus here in a second. Because I know a lot of you are probably asking, hey, what do we run before we get the Hoplite Musket? I don't have it yet. If I'm going through the Hive of Gorgons for the first time, you know, and I don't have it yet, what I run? We will jump onto that in a second, but for now, Hoplite Musket is your best in slot in game. You're gonna be running augmented ignited, splitting that damage 50%, gaining that fire damage dot, and most importantly, stacking that flame attunement. Getting all those burn damages going, min-maxing for Hive of Gorgons, and again, it's just overall not going to do anything with Worm. It's just going to be extra damage, which is nice. Bleed, obviously, if no one else has a bleed up, you apply a bleed. Generally speaking, the enemy you're hitting is always going to have a bleed. Someone in your group is going to have a bleed. You're going to be applying a bleed. Someone else will. So, Finisher's Harmony is pretty much permanently active. This perk is never like, basically, no, it has no downtime. It has absolutely no downtime. Musket doesn't shoot faster than a second, so it has zero downtime. Now, on the finisher itself, we're actually going to be adding Disdained Infliction. This is the next perk we'll talk about, and also why we go with the Hoplite Musket itself. What is Disdained Infliction? Disdained Infliction is a perk that increases the potency of our dots by 15%. But the best part about this for PvE specifically is it also has a bonus effect of 5% extra base damage against hostile AI inflicted with a dot. Pretty much every single AI, just like Finisher's Harmony, is going to be inflicted with a dot. This is again another one of those basically permanently uptime effects, especially with your gem. So the best thing about Disdained Infliction is not only is it increasing your dot damage, it's also got built-in PvE Enchanted, which makes it a must-have PvE perk, especially for a range build like the Musket Rapier. So we've got that on our musket and on our rapier. Something I quickly want to mention is a lot of people are going to want you to primarily use your rapier for DPS, and that is correct. Other than for Worm, where you're a pad player as musket, and other than maybe the second and sorry, other than the first boss and the last boss in the Hive of Gorgons raid, you are going to want to use your rapier, and the rapier will jump into here. Finisher is going to be your main DPS, and Musket is more primarily going to be your offhand, again, other than those scenarios like the Worm, where you're exclusively playing ranged. So, we'll jump into it here. Disdained Infliction, again, comes from the Worm. You can buy the craft mod off the trade post. What musket are you going to be using pre-best in slot? You're going to be using the Syncretic Musket. The Syncretic Musket drops from named Brimstone Sands bosses. I will put an image up with a farming route that has got a loop of like five bosses, I think. That is the most effective for the highest chances and the fastest route, effectively, for farming this musket. Now, this musket comes with Keenly Jagged and a Boreal Attunement. Now, this is effectively a solid Priebus musket, right? You can add Disdained Infliction to it at the Gypsum Kiln and upgrade it to 700 gear score. It doesn't go to 725, that is going to be your Hoplite Musket, but this is the perfect musket to help you get through the raid. I wouldn't really recommend anything else other than Syncretic Priebus and adding Disdained Infliction to it. Now, it does suck that a Boreal Attunement isn't fire damage. It is a little bit of a not min-max, but again, this isn't a best in slot musket, so it doesn't matter at the end of the day. All in all, not having a Flame Attunement, you're losing out on maybe like 100 damage at the end of the day. This video, we're talking about min-max best in slot, which would be Flame Attunement, flame damage, flame harnessing, etc. All of that good stuff, which we will jump into. But pre-best in slot, you're fine with Syncretic Musket. Yeah, no problems with that there. So, next to that, we have the tree itself for the rapier, and we'll jump into the musketry as well. Musketry is a little bit interesting, but to start off with the rapier tree, as I said at the start, while we are using the finisher for the Finisher's Harmony perk, this is not a bleed rapier setup. You have specific people in your raid group that will be playing bleed rapier. Generally, they're playing finisher with VG or finisher with IG, usually finisher with Ice Gauntlet. Those are the people that have the bleed role. You only need a couple bleed rapiers, and that is not your role to fully utilize it. Your role is Evade Rapier, which in my opinion is a more enjoyable and more safe tree. Bleed Tree, which we're not covering here, is very niche, and again, you only need a couple of them that maximize that DPS, and to that point, it is much harder for survivability. The Evade Tree, however, this one I'm showing you here, you get so much mobility having this setup and DPS that it is my favorite tree. So you get Leeching Flurry, or Flurry first and foremost. We're going to be adding a Weapon Pair to our arm that is essential for this to work, which we will talk about in a sec. Evade, for evade spamming, so the last perk of evade here, sorry, third last, allows us to effectively reduce the, sorry, not second perk. Every hit of evade, basically, or every successful light attack, reduces the cooldown of evade by a massive percent. This is called evade spamming. You'll go up to the back of your boss, opposite your tank, you're not trying to hit, tank the tank's hits, you're trying to be the opposite, backstab the boss, etc. You're going to be effectively evade spamming. You're going to be spamming your evade key and your light attacks and instantly chaining that ability over and over. And then when it's off cooldown, you'll use flurry. And then riposte is your effectively a bonus iframe. If you don't want to spam, if you don't want to dodge, if you want to deflect an attack, there will be instances where riposte is perfect and is a really nice contrast for that mobility or that escape. Here you need it. So this is again is my favorite rapier tree, obviously picking up momentum, bonus damage, why would you not want it? Picking up both of the cooldown passives, very important for this tree. The last cooldown reduction passive on flurry is also important. Maximizing our cooldown reduction, maximizing our mobility, and having great DPS, evade tree, you can't go wrong, especially with a musket rapier setup. Next up, we'll quickly talk about and quickly segue into the armor artifact. Attune Leather Pants. You might say Nimble Coat. You might say Nature's Wrath. Nature's Wrath, terrible. You lose all of your timed empowers and half your permanent empowers. Absolutely dog shit. And last but not least, the Nimble Coat. The Nimble Coat is cooldown reduction. It, in my opinion, it is dog shit. Musket cooldowns are already so short. So, for example, we'll jump over to it here. Is the musket itself has extremely short cooldowns. So, for example, Power Shot, you're going to be using this, 12 seconds, Powder Burn, 15 seconds, and Shooter Stance is 18 seconds. That's the longest one. Musket has incredibly, incredibly short cooldowns, and you do not need anything that reduces refreshing, or reduces CDR, sorry. It is completely pointless for Musket. It could be worth it for Rapier, but again, as a Musket, as a Ranger, you're not going to be using the Rapier full-time. You're going to be switching between Musket and Rapier. So, why do we use Attune Leather Pants? Bonus stats. So, at 725, you get a shitload of stats off Attune Leather Pants. You get 45 Magnify, plus 11 Int, we're going to use that. Plus 11 Dex, we're going to use that. Plus 11 Con, we're going to use that. All in all, totaling almost 90 stats that you will use. 90 stats that you will use from this build. 45 Mag, 66... 72. My math is incorrect. 67? Yeah, 67. And then 78. 78 stats from Attune Leather Pants, making it, in my opinion, the best ranged artifact for PvE and PvP of my PvP builds, if you've seen them. And on top of that, you get elemental aversion. You get a refreshing, that's whatever. To add to the Attune Leather Pants, you're going to be adding the harnessing, of course. So we'll jump over to my website here, which will be in the description and pinned, where I have my full best-in-slot kit laid out if you want to quickly reference it without jumping back into a video. You can reference everything here. So we'll quickly jump over the more specifics here. For the armor here, we're going to be running full harnessing setups. So we've covered our weapons, finisher and hoplite musket, and pre-Bis Syncretic Musket if you can't get the Hoplite yet. So, we're covering Bis Armor here, but it sort of has the same direction of perks, basically. So, we will cover pre-Bis, but until then, we'll quickly cover Bis here. So, for best-in-slot PvE Musket gear, we're going to be running Fire Harnessing and Enchanted Ward with Weapon Perks to top it off. So, for the Gorgonite Mask, Fire Harnessing, Enchanted Ward, and last but not least, Leeching Flurry. Leeching Flurry is a must-have perk in PvE. This thing is amazing, especially contrasting with the Rapier perk. Flurry. It is absolutely amazing, and I highly recommend using it. It is going to give you 0.5 seconds of invulnerability and a massive amount of leeching. If you use this right and time it right, you are basically invincible when you are tanking, or not tanking, so when you're tanking or take a hit from a boss or an ad, you can survive, and especially contrasting that with the repost, with evade, you get all that mobility, all that invulnerability. Evade is also an iframe, by the way, and repost again can also be used to stop an attack. And now leeching flurry also has that utility if you need it, and most importantly, leeching flurry, which is a cracked perk, must have. You need leeching flurry over above all else. Min-max enchant ward, generally a really good PvE perk. Fire harnessing is fantastic. Again, we're splitting our damage to fire to min-max that Hive of Gorgons bonus damage, and it's just bonus damage in general for the worm. For the worm, again, we don't need a specific damage type, but we're building for the Hive of Gorgons, and this gear can be usable for the worm with no losses. For our gems, we're going to be using, obviously, Ignited, again, buffing our fire damage and our fire split. And alongside that, we're using Physical Damage Absorption. You're probably wondering, what about Elemental Resistances? We'll jump onto that later with Jewelry. For armor, you want to run Flat Onyxes. It is important and is more consistent, and is most importantly, going to save you a fuck ton of gold instead of having to switch gems all the time. So, onto the next thing, or the next best in slot piece, is the Silken Cocoon. This is a name chestware that is RNG and it comes from the worm. This has two illegal perk combos on it, making it very fucking OP for PvE. It has Shirking Energy on the chest and Keen. Now you're probably wondering, Keen and Shirking Energy on the chest, that is interesting. The worm has some of the best illegal perk combo name gear in the game. There is a chest or a headpiece that healers really want. There's Keen Speed Boots that a lot of melee want. And there is medium boots that a lot of ranged really want. And last but not least, a chest that a lot of PvE ranged would want. So, what makes this chest so good? Things like the worm and other bosses don't actually, or like Ichna is a perfect example from Hive of Gorgons, do not have a headshot. So, if you didn't know, Musket deals a crit damage on a headshot, guaranteed, right? But a lot of bosses in PvE don't have headshots, which makes Keen actually become useful, and makes this a best-in-slot, like, in-game goal for PvE Musket for Hive of Gorgons and for the Worm. Because, again, some of those mobs do not have headshots where you want that extra crit chance, and it's going to be very beneficial to you. Adding Fire Harnessing is the third perk there. You can upgrade Worm Gear to 725 if it is named. Again, adding the Ignited Physical Ward. And again, we will jump onto Priebus. We're just covering the best in slot stuff, and then we'll jump into what you run before you get this stuff. Onto the hand covers here, running the Gorgonite hand covers. This is just a crafted piece. And we're going to be running, similar to our head, we're going to be running Enchanted Ward Fire Harnessing. And last but not least, another very important weapon perk, Omnidirectional Evade. And just like the name suggests, this is a perk that amplifies off the ability Evade. When we evade spam, we effectively get 11.7% bonus damage on our evade. So when we're evade spamming, backstabbing a boss, we're just going to keep getting bonus damage on our subsequent attack, which is fantastic for DPS and min-maxing, and is another must-have perk in my opinion. So alongside your leeching flurry is another just massive increase to your DPS and utility, and is going to help you a lot min-maxing your range setup. Last but not least, we've got the Attune Leather Pants, which we have added fire harnessing to because we don't need shirking energy now, because that's on our chest. So we add again Ignited Physical Ward and again fire harnessing to the Attune Leather Pants. We'll jump onto the stat split at the end here, and last but not least, for the best in slot PvE musket setup, is the June Eplantula. Now, I don't know how to say that name. These also come from the Sandworm Trial. These have an illegal perk combo that is also very OP, that I also put in my PvP builds, Enchanted Ward and Elemental Aversion. There's something I quickly want to note here. Elemental Aversion as a ranged player is fantastic for PvE. Elemental Aversion, and specifically for the Sandworm Raid, the 20-man raid, helps with acid resistance. I've looked this up on Neural Buddy, but effectively, 4.5% less acid damage for for elemental aversion. And we have one piece on our pants as well, which is great. So we get almost 10% acid resistance, which is a nice bonus to have, especially for things like the last boss in Hive of Gorgons 2 with Broodmother Medusa, who spits a lot of nature damage. But again, just like I mentioned, Enchanted Ward also helps and is probably the better option, but the great thing about these boots is it has both. And last but not least, we're adding the Fire Harness onto that there and going for the Ignited Physical Ward. Onto the jewelry, last but not least, is we have the Sharnishan Amulet. The Sharnishan Amulet, also like the boots and the chest, comes from the Sandworm. The great thing about this is that it is again, once again, upgradable to 725. You can add a last perk to it. It comes with health and stamina recovery. You don't actually need stamina recovery in PvE. You want health, that's fantastic all around. But Empowered is the important one here. We have a lot of timed empowers on Musket, and in PvE, you might not be proccing them as often as you would in PvP. Because, you know, you may have a single target. I know that a lot of the Musket empowers are conditionals like Headshot, etc., where you might not see them pop up as often, and you can truly min-max and utilize that empower that you get by using Empowered and making those empowers last longer. Such as, I think Hide and Precision does scale with Empowered. You get them for longer, basically. It's an all-round, a consistent, good perk to have that is, in my opinion, best in slot for PvE. And this can also be used for PvP, so you can double-purpose this amulet as well. Next off, we have the ring. Now, I have gone for fire damage, hardening, and burning, but there is an alternative here. You can swap burning out for bloodletting if you so choose, or even leeching as your third perk. It is entirely up to you. Of course, you want to lock in hardy and fire damage, though, as your two musts. But, so you please, you can go with burning or bloodletting, or, last but not least, you can go with the leeching now. Something else I quickly want to mention is the gems we run in jewelry before we get on to the Endless Thirst here. Gems and jewelry, I'm showing opals, but this is the slots you want to change around depending on the content you do. So, if the mutation you're doing that week is Void, you would want to put Amethysts in your jewelry. If you're doing the first two bosses of the Hive of Gorgons raid, you want Jaspers. For the last boss of Hive of Gorgons, Broodmother Medusa, you want Ambers because she does nature damage. For the Worm, you want Opals because that does acid resistance. And then, let's say it's Ice Week for a mutation, you want, obviously, you know, you want Aquamarine. So you can change around your gems freely in your jewelry depending on the content you do while keeping your armor gems and jewelry intact so you don't have to switch them around all the time where they're more expensive, and instead you can just go much cheaper and just switch around your resistances in your jewelry. Again, so last but not least, we have the Endless Thirst. We have added Refreshing Toast to it here. And this is important because this is using something called backbarring. Well, what I like to call it is backbarring mana potions. Now, you're probably wondering, we don't use mana in this build at all, right? It's a range build, we're not using any magic. But that is for this exclusive perk that comes with the Endless Thirst. Actually, it's not exclusive, but it is a perk that comes with Endless Thirst that we can utilize to get extra timed empower. This helps with Empowered, which we have on our amulet, and again, those mana pots. So, Empowering Toast, on Potion Drink, gain 10% empower for 8 seconds. This is utilized by those mana pots, which are on a 13 second cooldown without Refreshing Toast. But, with Refreshing Toast and Empowered, we can knock that cooldown back to, I think, 11 seconds or 10 seconds, I can't remember. And make that empower last that entire 10 to 11 seconds instead of 8 seconds with our empowered on our amulet, which means we can effectively, backbarring our mana pots, have perma 10% empower uptime when we get into that rotation of remembering to pop the mana pot. It does take a little bit to get the muscle memory down for backbarring mana pots, but once you do it, it is beneficial and you will notice a general increase in your DPS more consistently, which is why I highly recommend it. Last but not least, running the Stalwart Heart Rune of Stoneform. The Stalwart Heart Rune of Stoneform is great for tanking mechanics, abilities, and if you generally just need a heal without using a potion, it is fantastic, right? There's in my opinion, not really any other heart rune you want to use for PvE. You could get away with the heart rune of Cannon Blast as well, if you so please, but it is entirely up to you. And last but not least, we'll jump onto the stats. Probably the most important part of dealing damage in PvE. We're going to go Glass Cannon. Now, you're probably wondering, you're going to be a one-shot to most things. Yep, you are absolutely going to be a one-shot to most things, but that's where something important comes in that I want to mention. This build comes down to having very, very good game sense, iframes, and timing, and knowing exactly how to play. But if you find yourself learning the build and taking damage, simply drop some dexterity for some constitution. Just bump it up to 50 con from dex to 100 con, depending on your level of comfortability or your, you know, how confident you are with the build. That will sort of determine how you should play and effectively, again, like, you know, how confident you are with the build. The more confident you become, the more you learn the build, you will be able to go true Glass Cannon, which is this stat split here. This is what I run for Worm, full Glass Cannon, max damage. We hit up to 30k in some instances, around 15 to 18k on average. This is what I recommend. But if you're learning, once again, drop some dexterity, 50 con, 100 con, depending on your confidence and understanding of the build. Do not just run Glass Cannon without understanding and learning the build, and most importantly, having game sense, because you would be inting your team, right? Only go Glass Cannon if you're confident that you can be good at it and help your team. Again, if you're not confident, please put more con. Nothing is worse than a dead teammate that can't help you in the raid. And Glass Cannon Musket is one of the most high-risk, high-reward builds in the game for PvE and PvP, in my opinion. Also one of the most underrated and most shit-talked builds in PvE, and we're here to prove the haters wrong. Anyways, jumping into the rest of it here, we've covered the trees, we've covered the stats, we've covered the best-in-slot armor, which you can always reference on my website, and even clicking on the images on my website will take you to the recipe on your database, like so. What is the Priebus armor and jewelry? Priebus armor is something called the Azoth Crystal Set. This is, in my opinion, some of the best gear that you can get if you don't have best in slot. This is 700 gear score upgradable stuff that is pretty much close to, if not the exact same, perks as its 725 counterpart, except you don't get those few extra stats and base damage increases at 725. So, Azoth Crystal Ring, you can add void damage to this, fantastic. Azoth Crystal, Azoth Crystal Shirts. Nope, I forgot the name of the armor here, give me a second. Yeah, Azoth Crystal Shirt, it was Azoth Crystal Shirt, I spelled it wrong. Azoth Crystal Shirt and the Azoth Crystal rest of it here is all light armor, and it comes with Enchanted Ward and Refreshing. Perfect. You know, we don't need the four-piece Refreshing, that's whatever. But the good thing about it is it comes with Enchanted Ward, and we can add Weapon Perks or Harnessing as our third here. Now, I'm going to recommend you add Harnessing as to min-max your DPS, but leaving one spot for Leeching Flurry. You don't need Omnidirectional Evade as much as you need Leeching Flurry. In my opinion, order of priority for weapon perks, Leeching Flurry, right? Definitely make sure your Priebus armor has Leeching Flurry on it. Omnidirectional Evade, I would recommend it, but it's not a must compared to Leeching. And then your other perk slots on your Azoth Crystal set, you can add in the Void Harnessing. And again, this is just a fantastic set. There is two ways to obtain this. This comes from Mutation Level 2, or you can use Dense Mutator Materia, which you get from any mutation level upon completion at varying amounts depending on the level. You'll go to the Gypsum Kiln, and that'll allow you to craft pieces of the Azoth Crystal set and add a perk to it, last but not least. You're going to be using the Endless Thirst still, by the way. That comes from Mutated Savage Divide, if I forgot to mention that there. Also, the rapier, I might have forgotten to mention where that comes from. That comes from Mantra Pal of the Unruled, which is a boss which you would probably want a couple people for to take on in the Isle of Zuravan. He's located here. But other than that, you know, you're backbrowing your mana pots, your glass cannon if you're confident. If you're not confident, you're running less, more con over decks. We covered the trees. And I think, yeah, we last but not least, actually, we haven't covered the musketry. So, last but not least, the musketry. The musketry itself is very interesting. So, I'm going to show it here. We're going to be running the right capstone, which is called Lethal Combo. What Lethal Combo does is it gives us 17% bonus damage to debuffed musket. To enemies debuffed by musket effects on the tree. So, for example, our Powder Burn is going to give us increased damage in combination with Lethal Combo, but only those debuffs from the musket tree will provide and work off lethal combo. Now, you're probably wondering, why not use Deadeye? Deadeye is for collaterals and headshots, and as we mentioned towards the start of the video, some bosses do not have headshots in PvE, such as Echna or, you know, the Sandworm, right? Where you're not going to be utilizing this perk at all other than additionals or adds. So we're going to be running Powder Burn, Power Shot, and Shooter Stance. We're not running traps, but we have to pick up traps or any of the other abilities to get the right capstone, as you need to have 11 points spec'd to get a capstone. Making sure we get that right capstone, picking up our passives here, obviously picking up Tactical Reload, Armor Breaker, I don't think it's called Armor Breaker, but it's that one that does armor pin damage. Damage below a certain HP threshold, obviously want ignited, more damage on a burning target, so effectively ignited plus lethal combo is going to give you, you know, I think what, 25% bonus damage to musket debuff targets or musket powder burn targets. Power Shot, this is going to be your giga damage. Sometimes when you proc a Power Shot, you could see a number up to 30k, which you might see throughout the Worm gameplay. And last but not least, Shooter Stance is fantastic for burst. Works great in Echna, the first boss in Hive of Gorgons, where you have a lot of downtime to use it. And last but not least, is fantastic in the Worm for shooting Acid Spit, and once again, Burst, because you have a lot of downtime to use it. And the last boss in Hive of Gorgons, Broodmother Medusa, also can have a lot of downtime for Shooter Stance, right? This is the tree I'd recommend for Musket. I think that pretty much covers everything. We may have forgotten to show the amulet I would recommend is the Tanglevine Amulet. Tanglevine Amulet, you can add thrust, it has thrust protection and health, and you can add empowered to it so you wish, which is a fantastic Priebus amulet. It's actually a great amulet as well, even for PvP. That comes from named enemies inside the Elysian Wilds. So we've now narrowed it down to our Priebus, which is the Azoth Crystal set with the Azoth Crystal Ring, with the Endless Thirst, the Syncretic Musket, and the Progenitor Amulet, or where did it go? I don't know where it went. The Tanglevine Amulet, sorry, as your Priebus setup, with the finisher, of course. And then, again, last but not least, your Best in Slot setup, which you can find on my website. If you quickly want to reference something with all the recipes hot links, you can do that as well. So that is the full Best in Slot, in my opinion, min-maxed PvE musket setup. There are a couple more things I want to mention, and that is the cooldowns and, sorry, not the cooldowns, the consumables you should be using, if you're especially new to PvE. There is something called coatings. Coatings are something you effectively use in PvE to increase your damage, and they are just a consumable that you can buy off the trade post, but I thought I'll mention it in here, especially if you're new and you don't know about them, because they do give a significant damage increase. Obviously, the two most important ones you're going to be looking at for the raids is the Angry Earth coating for the Hive of Gorgons raid. That's just an extra 15% damage. And then for the Worm, you're going to be using a Beast Coating, which is 13% bonus damage. I don't know why that's showing 13. Oh, it's the Tier 4. You want Tier 5, you just buy them simply off the trade post, and they'll give you a massive damage increase. Then you're going to use a Honing Stone, a Tier 5 Honing Stone, for both the Hive Gorgons and Worm, and other PvE content like Mutations, so you wish. And that's pretty much everything. For food, we use Fruit Salad. In my opinion, that's the cheapest. Where you're getting the most out of it. You know, it's like 80 to 40 gold per item, and you're getting 44 int out of that to maximize your stats. In my opinion, that is my musket PvE build. That's what I've had the best results with after doing numerous tests, numerous testing on stream. And I'll quickly want to throw in here that we go live every single day over at twitch.tv/mailoreo, 11 p.m. PDT. I'll see you there. Enjoy the Worm gameplay. And if you have any questions, more than happy to answer. Join my Discord or drop them in the comments below. Come up here. I appreciate that following, legend. Yeah, it's just a normal everyday shit. Dude, I appreciate that following legend. Damage is insane, yeah. I've almost got a fully complete PvE kit now with full harnessing, so. Wait, look at my powder burn tech, so they're checking for like 2k with my bleeds. We're actually speedrunning this right now, what the fuck? This could be a PB for our company. This is the 30k hit we got there. We got a 30k scope crit just then. We got 12k thrust, 18k fire damage. Powder burns are taking for fucking 1.45k, bro. What the fuck? This would be hard to find with Musk although they need it on some bosses. A lot of people have bad... Yeah, there's a lot of, like... People don't understand how underrated the Musket is in PvE. Because of its past, it's got a general, like... Yeah, it's got a stigma around it, yeah. Which is funny, because in my opinion, Musket is one of the most underrated PvE weapons in the game. I have a video coming out on it soon. Thank you. left in general chat using Musker and all three Gorgon bosses, yeah. It's so funny because they don't understand how much damage you're doing when you spec correctly. They're all about to be proven wrong. This might actually be a fucking insane run. Could be a PB. 100% it's a PB. We almost fucking phase skip too. Six game non-credit.